this morning, we welcome all of you to worship. I would encourage you to read the announcements for yourselves, which you can find printed in the bulletin online. There is a bulletin on our website. There's also a giving portal too as well if you're worshiping online. And you can read those announcements as well on our Facebook page too. The decorating committee asks that you bring an unmarked copy of a baby picture of you as a baby or a toddler if you'd like to participate in the bulletin board that's being created downstairs. There's a box right on Galbraith Hall on the table there, and we're going to guess who those pretty, pretty babies are. Won't that be fun? I bet that will be very fun for our young people who look at, say, our most senior generation and imagine what they too looked as babies and toddlers, huh? It always surprises us when we're young that our seniors were once young too as well. It's kind of hard for us to imagine, but awfully fun. Also, check that per capita has been lowered this year. That information you can find in the bulletin too as well. And if you haven't signed up for the church bowling party, please do so. Everyone here is warmly welcome to stay for the time of fellowship that we have just out here in Galbraith Hall, and you can find information about restrooms on the front cover of the bulletin. And at this time, I would invite the Ubrees and youth to come forward here for a moment for mission for an update on the candy sale.
Got a whole crew here this morning. We just wanted to update you. If you remember, we did a candy sale over Christmas, and it sort of started as we were studying Sunday school, how Jesus wanted us to care for other people and had some ideas of what we can do other than just locally here. And Madeline had sold chocolates at the craft fair and did pretty well. And so we used her seed money, and then we got the seed money from RAC, from the other youth group. So we probably had $40 or $50 to start with, and decided to sell the candy and the pretzels for Christmas. So our goal was to raise $250, and so we're here this morning to let you know how that went and what we were able to do with the money that we raised.
After expenses, we made $398, about $150 over our goal.
Originally, we had planned to buy a piglet, a pair of goats, a family of chickens.
In addition to those, we were able to get a sewing machine, a fishing net, a water filter, farming tools, and a set of 90 saplings.
We want to thank our parents and Mrs. Rogers for all their time helping and for their donations of supplies.
Thank you, guys. And if you didn't catch that, we raised almost, after expenses, almost $400, $150 over our goal, and we were able to buy everything that the kids told you there. So we wanted to thank also the congregation, because obviously we couldn't have purchase these things without your support. So thank you for your generous support for this project. There will be more to come. We have some other things going on for the youth group. You'll be seeing us up here again in the coming weeks and months to keep you updated, see how we're active in the church and serving others. Thank you.
Thank you so much, and that is good news. And it's so fun to see how our young people are able to distinguish the kind of gifts that they sense they've been called to give to those who need them around the world, and we thank you. And all of you who have supported this wonderful ministry. My brothers and sisters, as we prepare for worship this morning, I would invite you to settle yourselves deeply within this presence of Jesus Christ that is here in this time and in this place. It is Jesus Christ who stands at the door of our heart and who knocks. And when we open that door and invite him in, he has promised to come and be with us and to dwell within us. And so, my brothers and sisters in Christ, I invite you now to open your hearts and open your minds as we begin to worship God. My brothers and sisters, please join your minds, your spirits together silently as I offer our opening prayer of blessing. Loving and holy God, you have given us this Sabbath to rest from our daily activities, to set apart time that is holy. Teach us to put away all earthly anxieties so that we might be suitably prepared for this service of public worship. May the brightness and the clarity of your word take hold in our minds and in our hearts. May our lips praise you, our lives bless you, and our worship give you glory. May today only be the beginning of our deepening awe and wonder of you. We ask all of these things in Christ Jesus. Amen and amen. Please stand and join together in voice and in spirit in our opening hymn of praise. Come now is the time to worship. Please be seated, friends. My brothers and sisters, I want to invite you now to join together in our prayer of humility, which you can find printed in the bulletin. Loving and forgiving God, you know us all too well. We, like those who personally heard Jesus, are often astonished when we hear the mandate and the scope of his ministry. We, like them, hope for the wonders of Christ Jesus, but also fear those marvelous things. We are more inclined to turn our backs on opportunities because of our fear than to effect the needed changes that will promote healing and wholeness. Forgive us when we give lip service to you and then slip into inaction. Give us the courage of Christ Jesus to be his willing disciples. Help us to be people of promise and of hope. And hear us now as we silently confess our seen and unseen sins to you. In Jesus' name, we offer this prayer. Amen and amen. Friends, the truth is that Christ Jesus has thrown open the doors to our life in Him, transforming each and every one of us to become free of the paralyzing grip of worry, fear, and doubt. Rejoice, dear friends, and please join together, because through the waters of baptism, we have died with Christ, and we are raised with Him. With gratitude and with faith, we will walk the way of Christ. And this is the good news of the gospel, that in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
The first scripture reading is from Psalm 19. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims His handiwork. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night declares knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words. Their voice is not heard, yet their voice goes out through all the earth, in their words to the end of the world. In the heavens He has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom from his wedding canopy, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the ends of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them, and nothing is hid from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them there is great reward, but who can detect their errors? Clear me from hidden faults. Keep back your servant also from the insolent. Do not let them have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. The next reading is 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 through 31. Just as the body is one and has many members, and also the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? but as it is, God arranged the members of the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor. And our less respectable members are treated with great respect. Whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now, you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, then prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. All are apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, do all work miracles, do all possess gifts of healing, do all speak in tongues, do all interpret. But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way.
Well, brothers and sisters, this morning our gospel message comes to us from the lectionary reading in the fourth chapter of Luke, verses 14 through 21. And when I say lectionary, I simply mean that the church in its wisdom, the big C church, the big church that encompasses all of us, realize that if we read portions of the scripture every week from the pulpit, all through the week. In 3 years, we read the entire Bible. You can do it in about 90 days, too, and in a year. For those of us who like to do it liturgically, and when I say that, in community, in a community of faith, this is the portion of the gospel that shows up here in our third year. This is year C. We're in ordinary time, but we're also in the time of Epiphany, where we believe following on the heels of Christmas, the good news is still being proclaimed. Jesus Christ is being revealed to the world, and the truth in the ministry and mission of Christ Jesus is being revealed. And so that's what Luke's gospel proclaims to us today. And so I bid your attention to the Spirit of God that is upon these words that resides within us, that surrounds us this day, and without which we cannot understand the truth and the light and wisdom, the intelligence of God that is proclaimed within the Word. And so we thank you, loving God, for this living Word that still speaks truth to us today, that has the power to transform our lives, that has the power to reveal you, your work even now within our world, within each of us, within the universe. We thank you for that living truth that transforms us, that gives us hope, that gives us vision and understanding of what you desire for each of our lives here this day and collectively here as your body in Christ Jesus. We thank you for the wisdom that goes before us, that opens up this truth, for your intelligence that still guides the universe today, that roots that truth within our mind so that we might believe it and have faith in it, and our lives will reveal your authority personally to us and to the world. We thank you for your kingdom and for your authority that is here, that has been ushered and revealed in and through and with the power and the authority of Christ Jesus, in whose name we ask for this blessing today. Amen and amen. And so this is Luke sharing with us that Jesus is in the synagogue and he is filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, and he returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country, and he began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and on the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So a little bit of background, if you will. Luke, this is in the beginning of Luke's gospel. What Luke is doing in the first few chapters ahead of this, and if you've never read it, I would encourage you to do so. Luke is showing us who Jesus Christ is, where he came from, his lineage. That was important to Jews. Almost every good Jew knew where they came from, who their father's father was, and the land in which they dwelt. And Luke is also showing us the purpose of Jesus in this time and place. He's also giving us a description of not only who he is, but the proclamation of his mission, his purpose in this world. And this was a pretty big deal for the people in his time and place. Because what Luke is doing is he's summarizing the character of the ministry of Christ, and they were hoping for a Messiah that would overthrow the Roman Empire and overthrow those factions of religious life and political life that was oppressing them. And Jesus is essentially saying in this prophetic voice of Isaiah that the description of his ministry, his mission, is to overthrow the authority of principalities and powers of evil. The opposition to God in the hearts of humanity. That's essentially what he's saying. When people are trapped in structures of poverty, and I don't just mean economic poverty, I mean poverty of thinking and poverty of spirit and anything that makes us believe we are poor souls. And that matters to God. Proclaim release to captives. Think about how many of us are captives to thoughts that make us believe we're not valuable. We're not beloved. We don't matter. And Jesus is essentially saying, it's not how it is in the world of God. Are you blind and cannot see? I'm here to tell you, you are meant to be free in God. This is the year of the Lord's favor. Now, for the Jews who would have been hearing this, they would have been liking this to the year of Jubilee, which was a year of great forgiveness. And every 7 years, the land would go back to the people. There was a great deal that was given back to people. The slate was essentially wiped clean. So he's suggesting to them, in your presence is the authority of God that wipes the slate clean. Right? And why can he do this? How can he do this? Luke tells us he's under the guidance of the Spirit of God, in the authority of the Spirit of God. He's responding to his Father's leading, his Father's teaching. And Christ Jesus begins with mission, which begins with people. And that's what sparks their interest. I think for each of us, we're the same way. If something begins with us, it makes us pretty happy, excited. Right? And I hope we don't miss this point. Jesus, all through the gospel stories, and especially in John, in the Gospel of John, from about chapter 15 on, he talks about how he does what the Father tells him. I do nothing on my own authority, he said. I do everything that the Father tells me to do. And because I am obedient to the Father, and the Father's leading, and the Father's guiding, the Father loves me and gives to me into my hand all things. And then Jesus essentially turns to the disciples, and this is mostly in John, and says, because we have this loving relationship, the Father loves me, I love the Father, right? We listen to one another. I do what the Father guides me to do. Guess what? You're included in that. And not just the people then, us. We're included in this. This is all about a loving relationship in God. And there's a purpose to it. We don't just get to say we're chosen or God loves us. There's a purpose to it. And Christ Jesus is essentially saying in the scripture that he actually brings liberty. He doesn't just proclaim it. It's not lip service. And we know from the rest of the gospel story, it cost him something. It cost him his physical life. And we hear that next section next week. We hear this wonderful, old people like him. He's the hometown boy. They're behind him. And within a couple sentences, they can't wait to throw him off a cliff. Right? But here he's saying through the power of God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, that he doesn't just proclaim this liberty, that he brings it. And that he brings the salvation of God to free those who suffer from the oppression of life. Right? And this is an anointed, specific ministry, and it's prophetic. When we hear a prophetic word in the scripture, or when we hear it from a pulpit, or we hear it in a family conversation, It means there's a new era coming in to the world and a time and place. And it's about release. Right? So Jesus is proclaiming a new era is in their presence, and God is going to do something with that. And this, in essence, becomes the central teaching of Christ, which becomes really kind of morphs into, we could say, that it's a ministry that reshapes and renews minds. Think about that. We believe what we think. What we think matters, right? So his ministry and his mission, you see, has to begin with people. Because if people don't have their minds changed, nothing changes. Try to work with a 2-year-old. Who's going to wear those boots today on the hottest day of the year? You've been there, haven't you? Who's going to change their mind? They have to go outside and sweat for a while, suffer, and then they're taking those boots off, right? And when we have our minds changed, you see, then our hearts start to change. They soften. And our reactions to life, to ourselves, to one another, become more like God. Right? And essentially, when Jesus is proclaiming this news in the synagogue, he's saying, this is what God wills, not what your culture wills. Not what your town wills, probably not even what your synagogue wills. And he delivers this in a kind of truth, which we know now in hindsight is God's truth, but actually what it is it's now today our truth. It's the call of the church. It's the call of the church, which is an extension of the mission of Christ Jesus. We might have to let that settle for a minute. That the Spirit of the Lord is upon us because the Lord has anointed us, called us, if you will, given us the authority to do this, to bring the good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the people, the captivated people, to give recovery to the sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. How do we do that? Well, we do it in a lot of churchy ways. Christ is risen. Wait, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Right? Glory be to the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, so it shall always be, world without end. Amen. Those are the ways we proclaim it. But what does that mean? How does that change us? How does that get us outside the walls where we're doing something different? Because our minds have been changed. And our hearts turn more towards God's truth. And we allow ourselves to become an extension in the mission of Jesus. And what the church proclaims is supposed to be a fulfillment of this mission. Think about that. The fulfillment of the mission is Christ, of Christ Jesus, is what the church is to proclaim. And the values of that mission are reflected in a church's outreach. So we've got a call, which we believe is an extension of what Jesus is doing right here in these moments and all through the gospel stories. And what we proclaim is the fulfillment of that. So think about that. Are there churches that fulfill that? A lot of them that probably don't. Even sometimes some of us probably don't. And what we believe about that, our values reflect our outreach, the concrete things that we do, and the way that we do them, and the spirit of hospitality in which we do them. Because of what we believe in Christ Jesus. There's a wonderful church in Richmond, Virginia, St. Paul's Episcopal Church. Have any of you visited Richmond, Virginia before? It's such a wonderful historic town. Oh, yeah. Did you live there, Ryan? No, you've just been there. Have you ever been to St. Paul's? Maybe? No. It's right down in the shadow of the rotunda in the Capitol. Kind of go down the rolling hills, and they're heading down into the downtown at St. Paul's Episcopal Church. So it's kind of on a slanted street, completely landlocked. So there's not a parking lot, things like that. You get to park on the street, that kind of thing. But one day when I was in the city, I had toured the Capitol and I came down around. Actually, I was looking for a place to sit. It was about lunchtime, so there's lots of people outside, people sitting everywhere. And I thought, well, I head down to the church. I'm sure there's somewhere to sit, right? So I head down there. There's a lot of our homeless brothers and sisters in Richmond it was a really hot day, who were kind of draped down around in the seating areas down by the church. And I thought, this is interesting, because here's this beautiful church and our brothers and sisters that needed a place to be, and nobody was chasing them away. It was the first thing I noticed. Nobody was out there chasing them away. And there was a huge, visible, well-done sign on the outside of the wall, the facade in front of the church, that stated very clearly the hours of when the sanctuary and the church were open. And it was very inviting. And I went into the sanctuary and realized that they kept it open in the hottest part of the summer so people could come in and get cooled off. I was grateful for that. When I looked around this beautiful sanctuary that had Tiffany windows and a beautiful filigree, I want to say it was almost silver work font in the front, and it was extremely well done, very clean, big. And there were homeless brothers and sisters sitting in there very quietly, just getting cool. And I looked over to the side where there was kind of a doorway where people could go back to the restroom in the office, and there was a table set up with a very inviting big container of ice water and lemons in it and lots of cups. And I thought, yep, that's exactly what you need. Went over, got a cup of water, and being a pastor, I always neb around other churches. It's easy to do when you're a pastor because you can go places where other people maybe wouldn't let you in. You just say, I'm a pastor, I'm working. Right. So I meander on back, just like anybody else would, meander on back the hallway. And there were some restrooms and closed doors and things like that that came out in another space, kind of like our Galbraith Hall came out in another space, which went out to a courtyard. And then there were the offices that were closed, but they were closed with big plexiglass windows so that if somebody came and needed something, they couldn't necessarily enter in, which would be important. It's the middle of the city. But they had access to seeing a person. They weren't cut off from that visibility. It's a little like what we have downstairs, but no way to move it back and forth. And as I came around that corner, there was another table with ice water and things like that. And I realized when I turned around and looked, that was another entryway into the church doorway, because it was there was a portico out there and a little place people could sit, a little garden area. So people would come in that way. They could get water. And there were chairs where people could sit down and get cool. And up against that back wall and coming around that corner, outside water, there was another big, well done, and because it's Episcopal, it was needle pointed. mission statement, very clear of what they were. And they made it very clear they were in a city, and they believed they were called there by Christ, and there was a purpose to that. And as I was reading it, the priest came around the corner, he had his hands in his pocket, he has a nice smile on his face. He kind of said hello and kept going. And I appreciated that I didn't feel like I was sort of, who are you? What are you doing in my building? And there was such a spirit of calm in there. And I remember being so impressed by that because I knew that church had money with well-heeled people and probably politicians and high-ranking folks in the community, and they were better than okay at opening up their doors in the hottest part of the summer so that people could come in and get cool. And I thought, that's a church that knows what they're supposed to do with what they have in their call from Christ Jesus in terms of mission. And they fulfilled it, right? And it was obvious in what they held as valuable. They took care of their building, but they valued the fact that people get hot and thirsty. And they valued the fact that their staff needed to say, stay safe but visible. And they valued the fact that Christ Jesus had put them in a particular time and place, and they began there. So we might ask ourselves, how do we at First Presbyterian understand this gospel message, right? This good news. To whom is it suited, right? And how do we pray for it? Now, I ask Ryan's permission to share this with you. Ryan Hutchinson, who's a new elder on our session, he's been an elder before. He's new to the session where I'm serving now as moderator. But we were studying Joan Gray's book about becoming a sailboat church. And he said, and I'm paraphrasing, but he can give you a little bit more information. You'll forgive me if I get a little bit of it wrong. But he asked, have we prayed about a strategic plan, about a vision for our church? We prayed about that. Oh, some of us, yes. Well, kind of. Well, a little bit. He said, you know, we really need to pray for this. And what I found so impressive was there was no embarrassment there. As a Presbyterian, I kind of like that. We pray for this. And it was hearing it from an elder just coming on who was willing to put their deepest feeling and heart out there and be vulnerable in that moment, especially as a guy, and say, if we prayed about this. And it was seeing that witness of purpose, I think, that really made the session say, we're going to pray about this. We are going to ask God what we are called to do to move forward. And here's why that's so important, friends. Because structures in any organization, session, committee, institution, church, workplace, family, relationship, structures cannot change until the people who operate them change. And that's us. Right? The same way it was for these folks here, right? The gospel, the good news, the proclamation, the prophetic voice is not a commitment to change society, but to change the hearts of the people who make up the society. That's what changes society. That's what changes churches and organizations and sessions and committees and staff and families and us in relationship to God and to each other, right? It starts with us. When, however we want to phrase it, whether it's mission, vision, strategic plan, what makes sense to us, but Jesus is essentially describing here his purpose. And trusting the fact that God has given him this purpose. He hasn't decided on his own to do this. And that makes a difference because it tells us that God is very aware of the complicated world that we live in. Understands the roadblocks. Understands the consequences of sin. Understands why we go one way or another. Understand sometimes, a lot of times I think, why we'd rather stay in the desert than cross through a baptism of resurrection and faith. into a new life. Right? That's why we have a community of faith, to support each other in this call, to talk to each other through it, to pray over it, to ask for it, and then ask for the authority of the Spirit to give us the wisdom and intelligence to follow through. Because the truth is, you don't plow a field by talking about it. You put the plow in the ground and you go out there and you sweat and you work and you plow the field. Right? And here's the other thing. Any ministry or mission or purpose that God calls us to will always be rooted deeply in the identity of the people involved. Jesus Christ came as a fulfillment of his tradition. He was a good Jew. He went to synagogue. Everywhere he traveled, he went to synagogue. That's what Luke is telling us. Did he like everything that was happening in the synagogue and the temple? We know in the gospel stories he didn't. But he didn't leave. He constantly prayed. He listened to what his father told him. He did what his father directed him to do. And he could do that because he loved the father. And the father loved him. They're in relationship. You want to harm that relationship. And quite frankly, we're told in the Gospels that he came because God loves us. Right? So we shouldn't be too concerned when we start to be changed, or a vision or a mission is changed in a congregation, because it will always be rooted in the identity of who we are in our surrounding community. And here's the other point of the gospel. Whatever we take to be the heart of the gospel, the good news, the freedom, right? That will be the shaping force of our life. Do we believe Christ died? He rose? He'll come again? Do we believe, glory be to the Father, to the Son, to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, so it shall always be, world without end, amen. What God wants in the beginning, at the end, even now. Do we believe Christ Jesus had the authority then as Christ Jesus has the authority now? Right? This is the shaping forth, this is the shaping force of our life of faith. And this is the plumb line of the teaching of Christ Jesus. And it sums up his ministry. He believed he was called to this. He gave his entire life for this. He taught his disciples this, as his truth teaches us today. Does it sum up our lives? This text is a measure of the work of the church. Isn't a measure of our work. Right? He believed he was led and called by the Spirit. Is the Spirit upon us individually and collectively, right? And here's the thing, my brothers and sisters. In closing, I'll share this with you to reassure you. The Holy Spirit gives us something to do for God. The Holy Spirit gives us this. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. We don't have to come up with the greatest idea. When we pray to God and we are open and humble, God gives it to us. Then gives the courage and strength to do it. And then opens the door. It all comes together. But we often panic and think, I've got to come up with this. Oh, mom, it's overwhelming. I'm not going to do anything, right? Get paralyzed by it, right? But if it was as important to Christ Jesus in this time, it's as important for us today that we understand what we are called to and how we are called to fulfill it. And as we fulfill it, that what we value proclaims to the world what we believe about God and Christ Jesus and God and the power of the Spirit and the kingdom of God. So although it sounds simple, I know it's hard, I know it's challenging. But like our brother Ryan, I would encourage you and challenge you to pray along with the session for a very clear vision of what we are being called to do in Christ Jesus as a congregation that fulfills this mission, which is the benchmark of his ministry and should be the benchmark of ours. And trust me that I too will be in prayer for all of us in moving forward in 2022. Hallelujah and amen. And my brothers and sisters, please stand and join together as we sing and meditate upon the ways that God continues to speak to us today in the hymn of grace, Live Into Hope. Please be seated, friends. And as we come into this time of prayer, please remember the joys and concerns that are listed in the bulletin, the joys and concerns that have come through our prayer line, our prayer tree as well. Globally, our brothers and sisters in Ukraine and in Russia, in Eastern Europe. Our government, too, as well, lifting our government before God. Locally, federally, globally. We remember our brothers and sisters in Tonga too as well. Loving God, we thank you, we praise you that as we come before you with our concerns personally, that are often many, we thank you that you understand completely everything that is required in our lives to comfort and to guide us and to meet need. And we thank you and praise you that in this congregation we have been given such a legacy, such benefits that support us in our ministry and mission and purpose even now. We dedicate these gifts to you this morning, those that have been given here in the sanctuary and online, and throughout the week in time and energy, in volunteerism and ideas. We dedicate all of these things to you this morning. We trust the fact that those who are called to use these gifts and talents, that they will use them always guided by your Holy Spirit for the fulfillment of your purpose, so that as your purpose is fulfilled, through the vision and the work of the congregation here in First Presbyterian Church, that will reveal to ourselves and to the world, our wider community outside of these doors, what we value about our relationship with you and one another and the world. We ask your wider and extraordinary blessing to be upon our greatest needs, which seem beyond our capability to do much about. And yet we believe that nothing is impossible for you, that you hold this world. We say within your hands, within your wisdom, within your intelligence, within your authority, that we are told in Scripture that Christ Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. That behold, in Him all things are made new. In Him all people, all of creation will be drawn to Him. We long for that time of fulfillment and completion, and yet know that we are still in the midst of moving toward that completion. And we are grateful that you have created us and placed us in this time and place so that collectively we might pray, put our attention upon you, our intention of heart and mind to you, asking you to soften each mind and heart, to open us so that we might understand and have a clarity of your vision for each of us and for this congregation. That we might understand that vision and accept that that purpose comes from you through the power of your Spirit in Christ Jesus, that gives us every means to accomplish this call. And may we also understand that this is for a particular time and place and people that leaves a legacy and a foundation that the next generation comes to and may tweak, may change, may fulfill. And may we celebrate that you continue to work in each of us and in the world. World without end. Amen. We thank you, we praise you, Lord, that we believe you are with our brothers and sisters who struggle in systemic poverty, abuse, addiction, homelessness, loneliness, for those who suffer in the isolation of sickness, that your eyes are upon them, that you surround them and protect them with your angels as you do us. May we see each other as you see us, beloved and redeemed. May we see in each other the face of Christ Jesus. May we desire that your good news is proclaimed in all that we think about, believe, do, and say. And as we lift our deepest concerns, our deepest joys to you this morning, Lord, we trust the fact that you take them into yourself. And by the power of your Holy Spirit, we believe that life is truly transformed so that we might rest assured that in the end, that all shall be made well, all shall be made well, all manner of life within Christ Jesus shall surely be made well. And we believe you hear us now in the prayer that Christ Jesus has given to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. My brothers and sisters, please stand together and join in our closing hymn. They'll know we are Christians. That's the Green Hymnal, number 429. Brothers and sisters, remember you have the loving, living God within you, the resurrected Christ within you, the kingdom of God within you. You are called to take this out into the world and to never be afraid. For it is Jesus Christ who strides out before you. He goes ahead of you. He prepares a place for you and waits there for you. And when you lose your way, I guarantee you, he will turn back on that road to meet you. And I bless you now in the power of our living, loving God, our Abba Father, who loves you more than you could ever imagine. And Jesus Christ, who is the living revelation and manifestation of this life, this truth, and this way. And the power of the Holy Spirit that has the power to bind you together and to God. Alleluia and amen.